हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग। आई होप यू आर डूइंग वेल एंड स्टे होम स्टे सेफ। दिस इज़ आर वीडियो लेक्चर नंबर 6 ऑफ चैप्टर 4, दैट इज ऑर्गेनाइजिंग ऑफ सब्जेक्ट OC। एंड आई एम वैभव शाह। इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड द फर्स्ट 5 पॉइंट्स ऑफ द प्रोसेस ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजिंग एंड टूडे we are discussing last 2 point, that is point number 6th and 7th of the process of organizing. But before that, let us take the glimpse of the first 5 point. The first point of the process of organizing is clarification of objectives, where the main and sub goals should be properly interpreted and based on which the organization is formed. So, and there should be the clarity regarding the objectives. Then second point is the list of function, where we have to clearly list out all the activities to be done in the organization, and while preparing this list, it is ensured that not a single task is left or is repeated. Then third point is departmentation of functions. So based on the nature of the different activities, here we are segregating or distributing the functions on a similar, and similar functions are placed together, and then the division of work is to be done accordingly. And for that, the work is divided amongst the areas of the business, that is the purchase area, sales area, accounts area, etc., or on the basis of nature of unit, geographical area and work area. After that, once when we deciding this departmentation, then the next one is to determine departmental position and abilities, where the task to have proper person to handle the responsibility are created as per positions, and the abilities, that is the qualification of the persons, are planned accordingly. And we discussed one of the example which is given in the textbook also. And lastly, in last lecture we discuss about the delegation of power and responsibility, where the divisional heads, subdivisional heads and skill based heads are finalized and should be given proper power and responsibility so that they can perform their work well. And with that, the clarification should be done about each one's positions, and the person will get the idea of the responsibilities assigned to them. But for that, the necessary proportion of power and responsibility should be given to them. Now, after this 5 point, the next one, that is the point number 6th, is the establishment of interrelationship. So here, when we are delegating a power and responsibility, there are some of the persons who will get the highest authority, some of them will get the higher authorities, some of them will get moderate, and some of them will get the lower authority. So based on their authority and responsibility, or we can say power, here we are establishing the interrelationship amongst them. Highest authority will be the supreme power, higher authority will reporting to them, so they become the subordinates, and highest authority will become the superior. Then moderate authority will become a subordinate to both higher and highest authority, while the lower authority will become a subordinate to highest, higher and moderate. And when they are in the same line of the authority and responsibility, then there should be proper interrelationship amongst them is necessary, so that they can get work properly done with the help of others. So here in 6th point, we are going to discuss about the establishment of interrelationship. After the proper distribution of work and delegation of power and responsibilities among different departmental personnel, the formation of interrelations should be made clear. With the help of departmentation or departmentalization, the power and responsibilities are decentralized, but the same can be centralized with the help of formation of interrelations. So here in this small point, we are going to discuss everything regarding the interrelationship that are established in the organization itself. So after proper distribution of work, which is the point number fourth, and delegation of power and responsibilities, which is the point number fifth, among different departmental personnel, the formation of interrelations should be made clear. Here in organization also, it is work same as that is working in our social setup, that is in our families also, where father and mother is the highest authority and child are following their orders and instructions and reporting to their parents. Same way in the organization also, the interrelationship among this type of persons with the higher, lower or middle authority should be made clear. With the help of departmentalization, the power and responsibilities are decentralized. Line this statement. When we are departmentalize each and every activities, then we are giving some kind of power and responsibilities to the departmental heads so that they can work efficiently with their own powers or own discretionary powers or through own ideas. So when we are distributing the power and responsibility among persons, it is called decentralization. So with the help of departmentalization, when we are distributing the activities in the departments, then the power and responsibilities are decentralized. But the same can be centralized with the help of formation of interrelations. Here it means the top authority will take charge of each and every activities by themselves, and the bottom and middle authorities are interrelation with each other in a way that they have to follow the orders and instructions given by the top level authority, and they are having a very negligible power and responsibilities amongst them, which will be useful in getting the work done according to the needs of the organization, and the organization itself decides the different kind of decisions. So here, after distribution of work, the delegation and responsibility is divided and interrelation should be made clear. If the work is according to the departmentalization, then the power and responsibilities are decentralized or distributed amongst them. But if it is in the hands of the very few people, then the centralization is there, and with the help of that, formation of interrelations should be made clear. Now last but not least is the seventh point, that is to prepare organizational chart. When each and everything is decided in an efficient manner, each and every place is filled with the proper position and abilities, then next one is to prepare an organizational chart, which is a graphical formation of the different authorities that lies in the organization, or we can say it is the graphical representation of the structure of organization. So in order to enable the people to have the perfect idea of each one's positions, a proper map should be prepared. Such a chart should be properly prepared, and the same should be displayed on the notice board. Once the authority and responsibility is divided among the persons, they are very well aware about their position, power and their responsibilities. But to make understand others regarding this, it is necessary to some kind of display of the activities where each and every person can see and understand the power and position distributed among the different persons. So, in order to enable people to have the perfect idea of each one's position, that he can determine that who are their superiors, who are their subordinates or their colleagues or peers. And a proper map should be prepared. So the map, or we can say the structure, should be prepared where each and every position in a proper line or in a proper display manner is placed, where even an unknown person can understand the power and responsibility or the positions of the person. And such a chart should be properly prepared, and the same should be displayed on the notice board. So it becomes a very easy for the internal as well as external persons to understand the chart of this particular organization, and according to that he will understand about the centralization or decentralization in the organization. So here with this point we conclude this particular topic, that is the steps of the process of organization, which starts with the clarification of objective, that is the main and sub goals. The next one is the list of functions, where we are preparing the list and ensure that not a single task is left or repeated. After preparing the list of functions, the next one is the departmentation of function, where each and every activity is distributed among the different departments according to their nature of work, and division of work is done accordingly. And as we discussed that, the work should be divided as per the working area, nature of unit or geographical area. After distributing the activities among different departments, the next one is to determine the departmental position and the abilities. Here we are deciding the categories of the different positions based on which the main position and sub positions are decided. Then the person for that particular positions are recruited and appointed. Fifth one is the delegation and power and responsibility amongst these different departmental heads, subdivisional heads and skill-based heads, and that clarify the person's post so that they will get the idea of the responsibility assigned to them. After assignment of power and responsibility, the next one is establishment of interrelationship amongst all the persons who are working in the organization, so that the formation of interrelation should be made clear. And with the help of this, whether it is centralization or decentralization is decided. And lastly, point number 7 is to prepare the organization chart, from where the people are getting a perfect idea regarding each one's position, and it should be displayed on the notice board. So here you have to prepare a proper chart of the organizational activities, and along with that, as a student, you have to use different presentation skill so that all these steps can be properly displayed or mentioned, or we can say draw in a proper manner. Like you may use the stepwise fashion, where the first step, after that arrow, and second step, then arrow, then third step, etc. You may also go through the staircase fashion, that is first, then second, then third, in a proper distance. Or you may have the box of the different activities, or through the clockwise or anti-clockwise or whatever, but the presentation should be different than the process of planning and staffing, because you have to remember all these process in a proper way or in a proper sequence. Because if you are writing all these process in the same way, then it may happens that in a future either you will forget some of the point, or you are not able to understand or able to link this topic with the proper sequence. So basically we discussed this point in a class in standard 11th also, that how to prepare or how to present a different kind of processes in a different way. So you have to follow that particular instruction and write down this question according to your choice. But you have to remember or to learn or to mug up these questions so that it will be helpful in getting the good marks. Now let us move forward. Next point is point number 4.3, and we can say the heart of the particular chapter, or it is the crux of the chapter, that is structure of an organization. Till now we discuss only the structure, or we can say the word structure. But how it is formed, which are the different structures that are followed by the organization, or how the particular structure is working according to the need of organization, or what are the organization that are following a particular structure, how it is formulated, how the different activities is implemented, what are the success ratios, etc., etc., will be discussed in this particular point. So let us start discussing about the structure of an organization. Effective management depends on ideal organization. The structure of organization indicates types of organization, the nature, size and responsibilities of business unit, and its classification decides the type of organization. First one is linear organization, second one is functional organization, third one is formal organization, fourth one is informal organization, and fifth one is matrix organization. Now let us discuss in detail. Effective management depends on ideal organization. Ideal organization means there is no specific definition or meaning of an ideal organization, because each and every organization is following a unique structure which is very different from the other organization. So it may happens that we cannot universally apply any of the proper organizational structure to all the business organization, because the nature of the business, their working style, the culture of the organization, their power, position, etc., differently distributed on the basis of their work ethics. So any of the organization, if wants to be success or effective management, then it will depends on ideal organization. And this ideal organization is based on the working of the organization or their requirement. And that's why we are having the different kind of organizational structures, and we will have to follow any one of this structure. So it may happen that if the success of one organization is in the one organizational structure, then it might happens that the same organizational structure is unused for the other type of organization, because their working style, working method and everything is different from this first type of organizational structure. And effective management depends on ideal organization, because once you make each and every activity in a properly manner, then there is no need to change it frequently. And that's why the proper structure or a permanent structure of organization will helpful in achieving the goals in an easy manner. Sometimes it may happens that you will be bored by understanding this concept which I am discussing in a very detail. But it is necessary that you will understand this topic so that you can write in your examination very properly. Basically, the board is following the language of textbook only. But sometimes it may happens that you are not able to write each and everything as it is given in a textbook. But if you have understand, or if you are having a proper knowledge of this particular topic which we have discussed in the classroom, then you will be understand, you will be able to write at least nearest or 90% of the language which is used in the textbook. That's why I am discussing everything in a detailed manner, whether it is OC or economics. Let us move forward. The structure of organization indicates types of organization. This is the main thing. It means the structure of organization, that are the different structures or different types which are given over here. Here they have discussed only 5 types of different organization, but the structure is indicates the types. It means different type of business organization are using different type of organizational structure. Like trading business is using some kind of functional organizational structure, while manufacturing business is using linear organizational structure. In some of the offices, there will be formal organization along with informal organizational structure, while some of the offices are following strictly formal organization. So which kind of structure you are following will indicate the type of organization. If you are 100% following a formal organization in a strictly manner, it means there is a strict rules and regulations regarding do's and don'ts. And if you are not focusing on that particular activities, then that will attract the penalties or some kind of fines. And if you are performing very well, then you will be rewarded with some kind of benefits also. So that is the structure that decides the type of organization. Now the next line which we are going to discuss is very important from the exam point of view. Line this particular statement and the question will be asked like, which are the things that decides the types of organization? Or mention the different elements that decide the type of organization, and then you have to write this particular statement. And one surprising thing is that the marks for this particular one line of answer will be minimum 2 marks, or sometimes it may be asked in 3 marks also. So the type of organization decides on the basis of nature of the organization, that whether it is a manufacturing or trading or servicing organization. Second one is the size of organization. It means the whether the organization is large, medium or small, sometimes micro or tiny, or cottage industries are also there. So they all are having their unique future, or we can say their unique culture, and based on which they are selecting the type of organization. Third one is responsibilities of business unit, in which will be having the centralization and decentralization position, and its classification. That is, the responsibility classification decides the types of organization. So whenever it is asked in your examination that on which elements the type of organization is depends or decided, then you have to write the nature, size and responsibility of business unit, and its classification decides the types of organization to be adopted. Now here we are having 5 types of organizational structure. First of all, I wish to give a glimpse of all this organization structure. Basically, the types of organization which are given over here is just the model structures, because it is a unique structure, or it is a some kind of fixed or decided organizational structure that are adopted by many of the organization as it is. But as we all know that the principle of management suggests that it is the work of a manager and his experience that decides the activities to be undertaken in an organization. So same way, the type of organization which will adopted by the organization or the manager is also decided on the ability of the manager who decides him. So first of all, we'll be having the linear organization. It is also known as a line organization, where authority and responsibility are distributed according to the position in a linear manner. It means who are at the top is having the highest authority, and as we move from top level to bottom level, the power, or we can say the authority, is getting reducing with each and every steps. So here the work is done according to the power or authority of the person, and their interrelationship is very well established. While the second one is a functional organization, in which instead of distributing the power and responsibility according to the different kind of positions, here they are focusing on the functional areas and not on the departmental areas. So they are distributing the power and responsibility according to the different functional areas, or they are giving the powers to the different functional managers. And it is not necessary that these functions are based on the traditional functional areas like marketing, HR, production, etc. But it might be distributed on the basis of the discipline or administrative or factory, etc. See, along with this, there is third organization is also there, that is line and staff organization, which is basically the combination of these two. But as it is not in our particular syllabus, so we are not going to discuss about it. Fourth one is also the divisional organization, which are based on different division instead of this line authority or functional authority. And that divisions can be based on the nature of the product or geographical area, etc., which we discussed above in the process. Third one, which is given here in textbook, is a formal organization. Formal organization means any kind of organization which are following the rules and regulations or code of conduct in a very strictly manner. There is each and everything is pre-decided. The roles, responsibility and position of each and every person is very well defined, and they have to follow the orders and instructions given by their superior, and they have to complete their task according to the targets assigned to them. Then fourth one is an informal organization. It is totally opposed of the formal organization because it is structured on the basis of the love, care, affection, friendship, etc. It is basically the shadow of formal organization, because it can also be found in an organization where people are working with each other for a very long period of time. There is no specific rules and regulations regarding the activities, and they are eagerly helping each other in completing their task, like as we are doing in our classroom also for our colleagues or for our friends. The next one is a matrix organization. The aforesaid four type of organization are having a single line of authority, and that follows the principle of Henry Fayol regarding the unity of command. But here the matrix organization is somewhat the modern type of organization, which eliminate all these activities in a properly structured manner, and there will be having two types of authority and responsibility line in one organization, and both of them at the same time focusing on an employee and getting work done from them. Along with this, now in the modern days, we are having some other organizations also, which are not covered in our textbook, but like network organization, which we are seeing in the products like RCM, then Redu softwares, then Oriflame, Amway, etc., where the people are preparing
or they are structuring a different kind of lines below them, and with the help of them they are getting a business and commission on the sales of the different activities. Next one is a hourglass structure. It is a totally modern type of structure where the middle level is constrained, because instead of in-house activities or the managers at the departmental levels, all the tasks should be done with the help of computer and technology, where the top level and bottom level is connected with each other through the servers and computers. But as we are having only these five types of organization in our syllabus, we are going to discuss about each one in a detailed manner in forthcoming lectures, that is linear organization, functional organization, formal organization, informal organization, and matrix. All other which we discuss today's lecture is just for your knowledge purpose only, and there is no particular requirement to understand or to remember all this type of organization in your examination. So with this particular point, we are concluding our session over here. From next lecture onwards, we are going to start discussing with each and every type of organization which is mentioned over here in a very detailed manner. Till that, thank you very much, class.